The next stop is Avenue J.
Anyways, we're going to be speaking about Sarra, Copia, Sulem. She spelled her name various ways at various points in her career, literary and otherwise. This is the one that's recorded on her famous manifesto of the 1620s that we'll discuss in some detail. In brief, this is a woman who lived at the turn of the 17th century in Venice from a fairly wealthy Jewish family, very involved in literary circles, and something of a socialite, perhaps. One might think, if I could speak disparagingly, God forbid, perhaps kind of an intellectual lightweight in some ways, kind of dabbling in literary circles. But all of a sudden, when push came to shove, and she was called upon in a public forum to renounce her Judaism, these various Christian prelates who attacked her had not realized that they had woken the tiger, and she came back with claws and teeth that made them regret even the suggestion. So it's really quite a fascinating story, and it says a lot, I think, about gender and faith and the voice of the Jew with the advent of modern printing technology that suddenly represented a shift in the powerlessness of this minority as expressed through the activity of this one rather remarkable young woman. Her life, as we know it, is based on 7 years of literary activity. That's everything that we have related to her career. But nevertheless, from those brief 7 years, we can garner a tremendous amount of information regarding what it must have been like to be a woman moving in upper middle class circles in the Venetian ghetto around the same time as Shakespeare was composing his Merchant of Venice, which of course was also about the Jews of this region. So why don't we go straight into the story and learn a little bit about this remarkable woman. We don't have a clear and confirmed portrait of her. Many were made, but they were lost over the course of the last few centuries. Several of them have been described, however, including one that she described herself, which was later connected to a painting found in a collection and connected to Sarra, Copia, Sulem. So this could, in fact, be a legitimate representation of her. There are some discrepancies. For example, she is often referred to as blonde. Her blonde tresses are praised by many of her literary companions. But it's quite likely that it was dyed. So she would not always have been a blonde. Blondes are not that common in Venice to begin with. Among Jewish women, perhaps of Spanish extraction, less so. So it's unlikely that she was a natural blonde. So it could be that this picture, which clearly presents her as being a brunette, may be accurate. She refers in her description of her portrait to holding the weapons of love in her right hand. And it seems that she is holding something like laurel twigs, which were a gift that she had sent to one of her literary companions at one point. And in her right hand, she describes pointing to the region where she was wounded. And of course, her hand is pointing to her heart here, indicating that she has, you know, been love-struck. This love-struck aspect of her career, by the way, was in a highly ethereal, intellectual way. It's kind of weird. I have to say that if she were my daughter, and she was a young woman when most of this was happening, probably in her early 20s, I would have shut it down immediately. Like, I would be taking away the iPhone, no texting whatsoever, because this is really inappropriate discourse. But nevertheless, we have this discourse, so we see that she's engaged in it in a rather chaste manner, but nevertheless, just on the surface reading, quite titillating. At any rate, this may be an accurate rendition of what she looked like. I'm going to rely very heavily on the research of Don Haran, shown here, who is an Israeli historian who published a rather remarkable work which detailed the life and works of this young woman and translating them into this book, Jewish Poet and Intellectual in 17th Century Venice. It's all about the works of Sarra, Copia, Sulem. Okay, so this is a highly derivative presentation, no original research whatsoever, and please forgive the errors, no hard questions, please. Okay, so let's talk about her life. First of all, we have to situate it within the turn of the 17th century in Venice. Venice was one of the early European cities to have a ghetto. Jews were crowded into a fairly small region with living in apartment buildings as high as 9 stories, which was quite impressive for the era. Although they were regulated heavily in this European city, they nevertheless were quite active in commerce. This is a period of time when a lot of things are changing economically, socially, religiously, and so on. We spent quite a bit of time talking about the scientific revolution last week when we discussed David Ganz, but also at this time we have some unusual economic revolutions as the law of gratian is beginning to fade. The law of gratian is a church canon law, which refers to the prohibition of money lending between Christians. This was something that it was taken, obviously, from the book of Deuteronomy, from the book of Devarim, in which Jews are forbidden to lend money and charge interest from other Jews. But the phrase used there is from your brother. So Christians also interpreted that law the same way, and Christians were forbidden to charge interest to each other. And so therefore Jews, really from the 11th century onward, had a monopoly on money lending. This is not the place to go into a long history of the economics of money lending and how Jews occupied that niche, but it definitely was a saving grace, maybe not a saving grace, it was definitely a saving element of the Jewish community because they were the only people in Europe who were really allowed to charge interest. It was absolutely essential for any kind of developing economy to be able to borrow money on credit. If you have no credit, the economy grinds to a halt. And so therefore, for several centuries, the Jews were really well positioned to make a profit with this sometimes risky occupation. If you're interested in learning more about that, I have an entire lecture on the web on Jews and the medieval economy. However, by the 14th century, many Italian banking houses began to say, you know, this is really not such a great arrangement. We are missing out on a huge economic opportunity. And beginning in the 14th century onward, the Jewish share in money lending began to shrink and shrink and began to move from being major money lenders to kings and outfitting armies and things like this to more and more a much more smaller scale kind of venture, and money lending was slowly really on the way out as a monopoly for the Jews. Ironically, at the time when Shakespeare was writing about Shylock, this was when Jewish money lending was definitely on the wane. But nevertheless, that was the backbone of the economy of the Jewish community in Venice. Sarra Copia Sulem's father was a moneylender. Her husband, also a very successful merchant and moneylender. And so she moved in those circles. So it's kind of an interesting sort of situation where you have a woman in a family with a considerable amount of capital, a large amount of wealth, a significant amount of disposable income and time on her hands, so she could be dedicated to literary pursuits and to education as a whole. But nevertheless, she's trapped in this ghetto, kind of like a bird in a gilded cage, because of her faith. And as we shall see, there are many that wish to free her from that ghetto if only she would accept the waters of baptism. So her family, as I mentioned earlier, her father Simon, who died in 1606, was a wealthy moneylender. Her mother's name was Rica. There's a certain amount of debate as to when exactly she was born. This date is not recorded. Most likely she was born sometime around the year 1590, which would make her about 16 at the time of her father's passing. She records in some of the few letters of hers that have survived that her father encouraged her to pursue her literary interests and in fact to maintain a kind of early salon I'll spend a little bit of time talking about that in a minute, which makes sense. If she was born in 1590, she would be about 16. That would be about the right time. Other scholars have suggested perhaps she was born in 1600, which would make sense with some of the other developments in her life, but that would not make sense that her father would be encouraging his six-year-old daughter to establish a literary salon. She had two sisters, Rachel, known as Diana, and Esther, known as Stair. Perhaps you can see, even in the fact that they have dual names, that this is something that's reflective of the nature of Jews living in this society, where they would have, you know, their Jewish identity, and they would have also a secular identity. There was no hiding the fact that they were Jewish, but they could nevertheless have commerce with outside society. The ghetto, of course, was only closed at night. Jews would travel outside of the ghetto for business. The ghetto was open for others to come into the region as well. So it was certainly not a closed and an impermeable barrier between Jews and non-Jews in this society. I myself, I go by my English name, Henry, which I like to call my slave name, but I have a Hebrew name as well, Hillel. I will pause and take questions shortly. Just please wait till I get to it. Thank you. I will take questions later. I'm going to pause and get to those questions shortly. Okay. Her husband, Jacob Sulem, was married in, they were married sometime in 1610. Again, that's another indication she probably was born earlier than 1600. Marriage at 10 was not unheard of, but it would have been somewhat early for them. Her middle name is somewhat, or her maiden name, Copia, is rather interesting. At one point, she was spelling it with two P's, and all of a sudden, she abruptly dropped one of the P's. Why is that? So, as we shall see in a moment, one of the major affairs that she was involved with, literary affairs, was with a much older monk, a Catholic monk, who said that his love for her was so intense that he feels like he is one of the peas in her name and she the other, meaning that they were destined to be always together like the two peas in the word Capillo, and so therefore she immediately dropped one of the peas. So she only spelled her name with one P afterwards. Her family name, Selim, probably is spelled in different ways. She's herself spelled it different ways. It could have come from Shulem or Shalem, meaning complete, but more likely it comes from the word Sulam, which means ladder. As you can see in her family, this is not her gravestone, but it is from her family. Quite often you have the emblem of the ladder portrayed there. Sulam means like a Sulam Arza, ladder from the ground to the heavens. She also was very big into heraldry. You can get a feeling for the kind of class that she moved in, because she often, you know, sent letters with personal seals that would sometimes have things like scorpions on them, from her name Sarra Copia, like Scorpio, and the ladder is also figured very prominently in her various presentation. Okay, so that's a little bit about her name. Her literary activity, one other small thing. Her Sulem is her last name. I will pause and take questions at a few points during the lecture. So if you hang on, I will be very happy to address them. Why don't I pause for questions right now? Yes. Any other questions? Okay, let's go on then. She was moving in, as I mentioned, very high-level circles. Perhaps the most famous Jew in Venice at the time was Leon de Modena, pictured here, who was actually very prolific, writing on a wide variety of subjects. He knew Sarra Copia Sulem very personally, wrote many letters to her that have survived and so on. And in fact, he may have counseled her through some of the crises that she experienced early on in her life. But now let's return to this idea of the salon that I mentioned earlier. This is a fascinating kind of activity that Jewish women in particular were famous for. Primarily a little bit later, in the period of the Enlightenment, like the 18th century is when you see it being really prominent. But a salon is basically something that typically upper middle class Jewish women would invite literati to come to their homes just for open-ended discussions. and it sometimes these salons really inspired tremendous intellectual creativity, artistic creativity, gave the opportunity for young, principally non-Jewish artists, poets, and so on, to meet patrons, often Jewish, who would support their work, give them the wherewithal to continue their publications or their artistic endeavors and things like this. And this continued well into the early 20th century. Perhaps the most famous of them is Rachel Varnhagen, very important German Jewish woman. But typically the salon activity was something that Jewish women engaged in because there were no other venues for them to achieve status in the outside world. They could not, for example, belong to the same opera-loving societies. They could not necessarily move in the horse-racing crowds. I don't know if there were horse-racing crowds. I'm thinking of Kentucky or something like that. But they didn't have the right to gain social entree into those circles where Christian women of the same class would gain status. And so therefore, they established their own. They created their own venue, these salons, which ended up being like kind of the hot places to be. And if you were, intellectually inclined and you wanted to go hear someone speak on art or a new poet or a new novelist or something like that, then you would go typically to the ghetto and you would hang out in one of these Jewish women's homes where they would put on a great spread and they would gain fame through hosting these kinds of events. She instituted perhaps the first of these salons in Europe. This is quite early, already in the early 1600s, and it became really a phenomenon that existed right up into the 20th century and into America. She may have inspired the Accademia degli Incogniti, which was a very famous one that started immediately after her passing, with many of the principal poets that had already been attending her own salon. Unfortunately, her genius in this area is also what got her into trouble. So I'm going to start with three major scandals that she was involved in. And I don't want to explore these for the sake of their kind of, what's the right word, kind of like National Enquirer sort of feel. They are quite scandalous in reality. But they really say a lot about the emerging role of Jewish women specifically in early modern society. Quite fascinating, I think. Okay, so I'll pause now if there are any other questions before we go to the first of the three scandals. Okay, everybody wants to go straight to the scandals. Here we go. The first one is the so-called Seba affair, named after this man, Ansaldo Seba. So this is what happened, and this is the kind of thing that when I read it, my eyes just expanded, and I thought, oh my gosh, if this was my daughter, oh my gosh, I have to check with my own daughter to see if they'd ever done anything quite so crazy. I talked about it at the Shabbos table. Basically, imagine this young woman. We're not exactly sure how old she was when this started. She was married, possibly in her early 20s, therefore, also possibly in her late teens, but she loves poetry. And she reads, in particular, this long epic poem called Esther, which is about Queen Esther of the Bible, written by this elderly monk who, as you can see, if he's born in 1565, he is at least 30 years her senior. And she is so moved by it that she decides to write Ansaldo a letter praising his literary work. So far, not so bad. In fact, I asked my eldest daughter, who really liked the work of one particular modern novelist, that she found on his website all the books that influenced him, and she read through the whole list. And then after she read all the books that influenced him, then she sent him an email, and they had an email correspondence, and that's as far as it went. At any rate, she sent him a letter describing how, just gushing over how much she loved his book, so much so that she used to put it on her pillow every night so she would wake up to it every morning. And I'm thinking that's a little too much, right? That's like an overshare, as it were. But Ansaldo picked up this letter and he responded. And he, by the way, at this point is living in a monastery and has kind of retired from literary activity, but he gets this fresh, enthusiastic letter from this young Jewish woman, and he is like just inspired. So he writes back to her, and they start an extremely intense correspondence that involves, they never meet in person, but the tone of their correspondence is incredibly intense. Now, when I was reading it, I was sort of, you know, imagining to myself an Italian accent, because they're constantly talking about how much they love each other and how they have pictures of themselves drawn and sent to each other, and they look at each other and they imagine, you know, what it would be like to actually be speaking with each other. It's kind of weird, I know. He also writes to her husband with her permission. But I guess that's what people did in 17th century Italy. You could write letters like that. But what's really interesting to Ansaldo, and by the way, well, I'll tell you about it. What's really interesting to Ansaldo is the fact that she is Jewish. And he declares that he's going to make his last life project the conversion of this young Jewish ingenue to Christianity. And so he bends his literary efforts completely to the task of convincing her to become Christian. And over years of correspondence, she steadfastly refuses. Let me read to you one example of his writing to her. By the way, as the reason we have all this is because he decided, even though he was never successful, he loved his own writing so much that he published the book of his letters to Sulem, letters of Ansaldo Seba, written to Sarra Copia, published in Genoa, I think in 1625 or something like that. And unfortunately, he published all of his letters to her. He didn't publish any of her letters to him. So they are largely lost. A few have shown up in a few archives, but generally we have to sort of piece together what she said from what he said. Okay, so here's one letter. He's writing to her, "You could also object, if it seems to you so, that I have overstepped the limit of caring for you. Command me also, if you like, to refrain from my prayers, because your insults are favors for me and your prohibitions stimuli. I must confess that you did not succeed in sweetening your rejection of my prayers by your promises that you would approve some of my virtues. I claim no other virtue which you have to approve than that which makes me wish your salvation. Believe me, Lady Sarra, that your salvation will be lost if you will not awaken. And the grounds for this awakening have been set forth so clearly and distinctly by him that there is no need for a repetition by me. I beg you, read carefully the last part of the book I have sent you. Search there for other reasons which are not lacking. Read it aloud if you doubt, and pray to God that he may grant you illumination, that illumination which you, as you think, do not need, but which you really need so urgently. As to myself, you can preach whatever you find opportune, but do not take great pains to make me love the Jews, because I have freed you from such effort long ago. Was she not a Jewess, that mother of God, my gracious patroness in heaven? Was she not a Jewess whom I chose as the heroine of my poem? And you yourself, whom I made the mistress of my desire, are a Jewess. Thus, without my being obligated to cease to be a Christian, you may with good reason regard me as the most ardent Jew." Hebraissimo, you know, the most Hebrew. "But do not get excited if the love which I cherish towards you cannot remain inactive when the terrible danger that surrounds you stirs compassion in the depths of my soul." So you get, this is just like one of the lighter passages. Sometimes he gets super heavy talking about how she's going to, you know, fire and damnation, and that only if you would remove the blindness from your soul. And this goes on for years and years and years. Now, if you can imagine, just put yourself in her shoes. Here she is. She's in the ghetto, a beleaguered minority. She wrote a fan letter to this big author. He wrote back, oh my gosh. And then for years, he keeps writing these like stalker type letters trying to convince her to convert to Christianity. And she politely but firmly rebuffs him for years and years. And it goes on, and she becomes, so to speak, a project for the Italian literary community and also for the educated Christian community as well. Like, genug schon, enough already, right? But nevertheless, she keeps writing to him. And moreover, you know, again, we're only basing this on what he says in his letters, but it appears that although she rebuffed his efforts to convert him, she continued to enjoy the association. And she continued in many ways, I think inappropriately, in my humble opinion, to encourage this relationship. For example, sending him gifts and having her portrait painted, asking for a portrait of him to be sent to her. And to give you a sense of like, you know, sometimes we have this image of Jews in the past as being uniformly Orthodox. Like my kids, when they went to school and they got those little drawings of the Parsha, like Moshe Rabbeinu and Avraham Avinu, they all wore black hats and things like that. It's not necessarily the case. But so, he describes how he sent a small gift with one of his servants to her. And she was so delighted to meet his servant that she insisted on treating him like a king and serving him food. And she sang to him a sonnet that she had prepared. I mean, it's definitely not Beis Yaakov-style behavior. It would not fly. But nevertheless, it gives you a sense, just a feel, of the realities of what Jewish life was like for this class of women in Venice at this time. We don't have, at this point, any non-Orthodox Jews. There's no such thing. In fact, the word Orthodox doesn't exist yet. It hasn't been coined because we don't have anything against which to use the word Orthodox. So she was like an upstanding member of the community. And this is kind of like the range of behaviors that were obviously tolerated within the community. Today, in America, we live in a very stratified religious sort of community where certain things, you know, could get you know, under the writ of a fatwa or something, and other things are completely accepted. But, you know, so this is just giving you a sense of the realities of what it was like for a woman living at this time. Definitely not kosher v'yasher behavior, but, you know, she nevertheless maintains steadfast in her refusal to convert. And that was actually quite an accomplishment. And maybe I can paraphrase your question. Is there any indication that we would think that either of these parties wanted to make this relationship more concrete? Is that what you're suggesting? You know, it's also a brilliant question. And, you know, I wish I was more of a literary scholar to be able to read these things properly. Because if I read these letters in a 20th century context, I would say, call the police. You know, this is pedophilia. This is all kinds of terrible things. But they just go on and on with each other in this tone that makes me think that maybe this is sort of the range of acceptable discourse in literary circles at the turn of the 17th century. That's all I can guess from it. Also, you know, the literary scholarship that I've read indicates that this is just like, you know, like we kind of stereotype Italian effervescence and, what do they say with each other? They kiss on both cheeks and they say, bella, mi bella, right? And that kind of thing. You get the impression that they've just like way too much tomato sauce and a lot of just, you know, very flowery language, but it's an intellectual love affair. I mean, her husband is involved in this. He writes to her husband. Her husband's reading the letter. She's married. And the whole debate is, you have to come to love Jesus as I do. That's what we have to do. Okay, let's go on to the second one. Now, one thing we should not miss here is that this is very serious. This is, in fact, deadly serious, because the next scandal that she was involved in involved another member of the literary circle of her salon, a man named Baldassare Bonifacio, who was a priest. He later actually became an archbishop. And he was a friend of Seba's, a friend of Sulem, or at least an admirer who came regularly to her salon. And he came out with this devastating attack on his erstwhile patron, which was called On the Immortality of the Soul, a discourse by Baldassare Bonifacio to Signora Sarra Copia. Here, at this point, you see she's dropped the P. And this was an open and very clear attack on her, claiming that she doubted the immortality of the soul. She doubted that perhaps the soul was immortal. Now, this all of a sudden becomes very serious because the Inquisition is still quite active. We're talking now about the year 1600. The Inquisition was founded in Venice in 1454. We have a lot of Muranos who are still in Venice and in the region. Although there are some free cities like Ferrara, there are a lot of Muranos who are posing as Christians who are being persecuted and even still burnt by the Inquisition, and in many ways persecuted right up until the 19th century. And the Inquisition also was very interested in Jews who wandered away from key tenets of the faith. That is, what was the Inquisition concerned with? They were concerned with Christians who were Judaizing, meaning Christians who were slipping away from Christian doctrines and absorbing Jewish ones. In particular, you would think that would include Christians who were originally Jewish or descended from Jews, the so-called conversos. But they were also concerned with Jews who were not necessarily hewing to the straight and narrow path of Judaism. That was also something that was not tolerated by the Catholic faith. And therefore, the accusation that a Jew did not believe in something central like monotheism, or the immortality of the soul, that could be literally a death sentence for her. And so all of a sudden, this priest comes out with this really nasty attack, saying that, hey, I've talked to this woman, and I don't think she believes in life after death. And so what happened was quite fascinating. Even before it went into print, she heard that he was publishing this attack, and so she went into a frenzy of writing, and within 2 days, she produced this work, which she published before his work could even actually hit the stands, the Manifesto of Sarra Copia Sulem, Hebraea, the Jewish woman, which is a statement that she explicitly denies the charges of Baldassare Bonifacio and that she does believe in the immortality of the soul. So using actually rather aggressive and perceptive political literary skills, she outflanks her literary opponent and produces this remarkable work. Now, let me read you just a couple of pieces from this. And this is fascinating because, okay, the other part was kind of funny in a strange sort of way, but this is all of a sudden, this is when she takes it to another level. This is like everything that was going on with Ansaldo before was, you know, criticism of her, why don't you convert and so on. But all of a sudden, by accusing her of not believing in a central tenet of Judaism, he has woken the tiger. And all of a sudden, you see exactly what she's capable of. So the first thing she does, and this is actually I found really funny, the very first thing she does in this book, remember, she's being accused of not believing in the immortality of the soul. So the first thing she does is she dedicates the book. It's a small book, it's a pamphlet really, to her late father. And she writes to him in the second person at the beginning of the book, saying, to Signor Copio, my most beloved creator, this little but necessary work could not properly be dedicated to anybody else than to him who has passed the threshold of this transient life, because it confirms the thesis which I prove in this work, namely, that I undoubtedly believe in the immortality of the soul. Right? The point here is, if you're saying I don't believe in the immortality of the soul, well, I'll point out to you, I'm dedicating this book to my dead father, because I believe he can still read it. I believe in the immortality of the soul. To thee, therefore, most beloved soul, who hast incorporated thyself into that body which brought me into this world, to thee, my father, my most beloved friend, who, although spoiled of the earthly frame, dwellest and wilt dwell among the blessed souls forever, I want to offer this small gift. Firstly, because if divine goodness allows thee to participate in the happenings of this world, I should like to contribute to the increase of thy heavenly pleasures by the modest fame I was able to acquire, which I trust will not be less dear to thee because it was produced by woman most desirous but unable to do as much for the perpetuation of thy name as a son would have done. It's kind of an interesting sort of aside there. She's saying, I want to make you feel bad. I want to make you feel better, Tati, that you didn't have a son, because look, I'm a woman, it's true, but at least I wrote this book. And then, in order to give thee a small sign of the everlasting memory which I keep of the boundless tenderness thou hast always shown to me, accept, therefore, this humble token of the unlimited devotion of thy daughter, whom thou lovest so much, and who, if it will be allowed to me to enjoy life and health, as a certain amount of creative ability has already been bestowed upon me, will live for the honor of thy name no less than for her own. Now, this work, the manifesto, is not really significant, in my humble opinion, on a literary or philosophical level. Bonifacio's arguments that were very ad hominem, that were directed at Sarra herself, are also not breaking new ground philosophically. And her response, her defense, it's not Plato, it's not Aristotle, it's not high-level philosophy. But the fact that a young woman, she's maybe in her 20s at this point, would have the gumption, she obviously had the economic wherewithal, to stand up for herself in this very hostile environment and publish a manifesto. The word itself is quite large. You know, this is my statement of purpose. I'm boldly saying what I have to say. That in itself is remarkable. It could only have happened in an environment where women had access to a printing technology, had access to a voice, kind of like blogging in contemporary terms, but she refused to allow herself to be cowed into submission, something which she could easily have avoided simply by giving in and converting to Christianity and confessing her faith. But she maintained her identity as a Jewess, and she maintained her faith in the face of such a direct charge. Moreover, when you actually read the manifesto, there's some really pretty harsh words for Bonifacio. Let me give you another example of this. Tell me then, for God's sake, Signor Baldassare, what has induced you to write and print this tract and to involve my name in it? You say in Virgilian verses that God has chosen you for this purpose. This is ignorance indeed. So the Lord had at his disposal for such a sublime and important purpose no other more illuminated spirit and no more learned servant than just you? Of the host of all scholars, he has chosen nobody but you to deal with such a worthy manner? If the belief in the immortality of the soul were not implanted in the human spirit by other means than rational grounds, it would be served badly if there were not other than yours, which, although they emanate from learned authors, have been misunderstood and reproduced so badly by you. You want to deal with the soul, with immortality, with the most difficult and arduous question in all philosophy, which perhaps have been obscure to you in various aspects if theology had not come to your aid? You are certainly aware of the fact that you are neither a philosopher nor a theologian, and if I am not mistaken, I have heard from your own mouth that the sciences do not belong to your profession. And in spite of this, you have dared to touch with your fingers such a sublime matter. So it's pretty nasty, fighting words that she's not embarrassed whatsoever to speak. Now, one last quotation to give you a sense of her literary voice. I repeat what I have said already. This is not an answer to your challenge, but a simple manifesto to excuse my not making my appearance. There is no reason for a combat where no resistance exists, neither in words nor deeds. As far as I'm concerned, you may remove your armor, but even if you provoke me again with insults, I have no more intention of answering you, first because I do not want to waste my time, and then because I have no desire whatever to attract the attention of the public by my writings, as you have shown yourself so ambitious to do. Live happy. You will attain the immortality which you preach so eloquently if you observe your Christian teachings as well as I observe the law of Judaism. Meaning, leave me alone already, because you're not going to get anywhere with this kind of activity. This is a really impressive thing. Again, place it within the time and circumstance. Really, for her to come out with things like this says a lot about who she was as a person. Now, before I go on to the last scandal, I will pause for questions or observations. Yes, good question. So, unlike the Ansaldo affair, these were publicly produced. These were like in the bookstores. So these were books which were public letters for everybody to read. They were not private ones which were later published. What other people reacted to them? We do have some letters of the affair. There was certainly a lot of sniggering at Bonifacio's expense, because here he had a serious smackdown from this young Jewish woman. But we only have a handful of these kinds of reactions. There's no question they left her alone after this point. Oh, I wish we knew more about what the Jewish community had to say. We do not have a lot. We do have a few expressions of concern from Leon de Modena, who is well published, and he definitely supported her. There are some intimations that perhaps he helped her write the manifesto, because among other things, she had some learning. She had some classical Latin and Greek and so on, and she had some Hebrew, but it's not clear exactly how much of a scholar she was, but this manifesto is deeply scholarly, and it sounds rabbinic. So you feel like, maybe she had a little bit of help. And given the family relationship, it's not surprising that she should ask Leon de Modena, please help me, formulate my response. But the voice is clearly hers. It's her, telling Mr. Bonifacio where he can go. I think that's a very valid observation. And I think the part that's fascinating to me is that, like the internet, the availability of reasonably priced, mass-produced publications gives a lot of people a voice that had never had the possibility of speaking out before. As wealthy as her family probably was, she probably would never have recorded 10 words if it were not for the availability of the printing press. So now we begin to get a glimpse into the realities of life for women in the turn of the 17th century as a result of this developing technology. It's fascinating. And of course, the ramifications for today are huge, because we're living in a society that makes the Gutenberg revolution look like a little ripple, and the internet has totally changed everything. Okay, let's go on to the third and final crisis. And this is an extremely sad one in many ways, the so-called Paluzzi affair. So she had a teacher named Paluzzi, who was one of these non-Jewish individuals who were in the literary circle. And at some point, Paluzzi decided to defraud his sponsor. She found that he was actually stealing from her, like pilfering her goods, and so she fired him. He came back highly apologetic, and she accepted him back. And then, we don't have a lot of the details about these things. We have a lot of secondhand accounts. Apparently, he colluded with two of her friends to create an imaginary French literary admirer, just like the Ansaldo affair. And they kind of mimicked that, and she, as it were, fell for it again, at least as we're piecing together the story. Paluzzi arranged for a series of letters to arrive, telling Sarra that he loved her work, he read the manifesto, was fascinated, and things like that, and developing a relationship with her. She sent this imaginary admirer money. She had another portrait made of herself sent out to him, and the whole thing went on for quite a while until it was eventually discovered that Paluzzi was in charge of the fair. She charged him, and he was apparently convicted. We're not clear what the punishment was, but she suffered a great deal of humiliation towards the end of her life. That, in many ways, that was simply the same scam that she fell for with Ansaldo, but just this time for money. A very sad kind of end to her literary career. And that's basically all we know about her within the context of 7 years of activity. But it occasions a lot of sort of reflections on what it means to be a Jewish woman at the turn of this 17th century. And I'd like to just pause for a second to think about that. So how important was she in the scope of Jewish history? On one level, she's important because she is a data point. Just the fact that we know her name, we know what she did, we know what she thought based on her writings. We would love this kind of data for any women at the turn of the 17th century because there's so few bits of information that we can use to recreate the social history of Jews at this time. But I think there's a lot more that we can say about her personally and the kind of, you know, position that she took with regards her interlocutors. You know, she was assailed publicly for her Judaism. She was put on the spot and she was humiliated publicly in an attempt to get her to convert to Christianity, which would have solved her problems and would have simply taken her off the storyboard of Jewish history altogether, but she refused to give in to these not inconsiderable pressures. We know a little bit about her own personal history, something I haven't shared with you very much. We know, for example, that although her marriage to Jacob was apparently happy, you have to wonder about the nature of their relationship if she's engaging in these kinds of very intense correspondences with others. She was a mother, but her only daughter died in infancy. She had a bad miscarriage later, and she refers to several bouts with very serious illnesses that makes one think that perhaps the miscarriage resulted in her later inability to have more children because she never did. So she certainly endured a lot of personal sadness in her own life that we can only get as hints, for example, through Ansaldo's correspondence with her. Nevertheless, the picture that emerges of this very human young woman is of a brave person who is striving to create a bridge for her own personal identity within both the Jewish world and within the secular world at the same time. Even though there are elements which we would consider fundamentally incompatible, nevertheless, it is her passion to read this poetry. She loves being engaged with thinkers and with poets, regardless of their background. She is tolerant to an incredible degree to hear their descriptions of what is important to them. And at the same time, she maintains her own boundaries and she maintains her own faith and position within the Jewish world. And in that regard, it's hard to call her a feminist. To use that term anachronistically to the turn of the 17th century, I think would be an abuse of the term. But nevertheless, she is certainly a proud Jewish woman. She is someone whose stance for her faith is something that we can give to our own daughters as a role model, at least in part. And I myself take a lot of personal meaning from her life story. Well, I hope you enjoyed that lecture. I certainly did. It was fascinating doing the research on this young woman, and I literally laughed out loud at some passages in her manifesto and was fascinated with the correspondence she had with Ansaldo Seba. And I want to take this moment to express my gratitude to all of you for watching these videos. I especially appreciate it when some of you actually come and show up in person. We had a few guests over the last couple of weeks that have seen these videos in various online formats and then have actually come in to see that it happens in real life. I think that's fantastic. I also want to put in a plug here for the fact that, you know, here at the college, 2/3 of our students are women. We spend a tremendous amount of energy educating future female Jewish leaders. We take great pride in it. We regard it as a very important aspect of our mission. And I want to share this mission with you and invite you to participate in it with us. You'll see on the bottom of your screen or on the top, a little letter I, an opportunity if you'd like to support the mission by donating to scholarships for our students. I think that would be a fantastic thing. And I tell you what, if you have that little letter I in the top of your screen, please click on it.
Even if, you know, you just want to appreciate the video and you enjoyed the lecture, just click on it, because I see how many people click on it. I don't see your actual personal ID, but I do see that people click on it. It makes me feel good to know that people out there believe in what we're doing and want to share in the mission. So anyways, that's it. Thank you very much for watching. I hope you enjoyed the video, and I look forward to speaking with you in further lectures. Thank you very much.
Stand clear of the closing doors, please.